Jim, isn't it amazing when Michigan can keep this game to a 19-foot, 9-inch game inside that 3-point line? It's all there. Nice throw by Steve Fisher here. Turn it into the 19-9 game.
Welcome to the 19-9 podcast. This is Josh Barnett with High Volume Shooters, and I'm here with my buddy Dan Woods, and I have my two idiot cousins in the other room being straight-up assholes, and we're going to try to get through this as best we can. We are going to talk about the second tier of Blue Bloods for those of you that tuned in to the first pod that we had. What was that, last Sunday that we were down here?
A week ago.
So we were down here talking about the Blue Bloods, and we posted that. And then we wanted to come back and kind of get the second one. So we might sound a little distracted. That's because we have some, like I said, assholes in the other room that
are live.
I mean, this is like, I feel a lot of pressure. I'm actually sweating underneath.
I'm super nervous. Nice Paul Pierce jersey on, though.
The Paul Pierce jersey is legit.
1995 Kansas. Great jersey. And the All-Star game is going on also.
You look good in it, though.
I mean, I do pull it off. Michigan long sleeve on top underneath it too.
I would like to see it without the long sleeve underneath it. Well, is that possible?
Not quite yet.
How many pounds away are we from that, seeing that happen?
20 pounds.
20 pounds.
Okay. I fluctuate.
We're all cheering for you, Dan.
Costa Rica in 3 weeks.
Holy shit, I cannot wait to see those vacation pics. Hopefully of you in that jersey and nothing else.
You got it.
All right, so run down real quick the schools that we talked about last time when we were talking about our top tier Blue Bloods as it currently stands. There were some controversial picks.
Yeah, so we'll go Kentucky 1 because you sold me on Kentucky 1. We went Carolina 2 and Kansas 3. We said those three were untouchable. Those three are just the ultimate. But we had to put Duke in as the fourth because they have 5 titles and – what they've done since 92 is just, it's incredible.
Yeah, they're kind of like the new blood, though, in a way. But not really, you know, because, I don't know, it's such a tricky thing, right? Because it's our lifetime. We only know our lifetime, really. And then you think about, like, where do Blue Bloods start? And I think the one thing that we agreed on was the UCLA stuff and how get out of here.
Don't worry about that.
how UCLA was the past glory UCLA teams as opposed to what's been going on there. And, you know, do they get their blue blood status from John Wooden, but are they a truer blue blood than a Duke?
And I think that's what you have to look at with Duke, because Duke right now, maybe in 20 years when this whole Coach K thing's gone and it goes from there and they fall off the map, then you take them out because you can say that 30-year run was just by the greatest coach maybe in the sport of all time.
Yes.
So I think that's where you're like – but Duke has to be in there. I mean, literally can't.
So how do you work yourself into becoming a blue blood, I guess is my question.
Has to be longevity, has to be titles, has to be consistency. Home court advantage, too, is a massive one. That's why UCLA, to me, they don't have all those things now. And I guess it's just it's so subjective, though.
Right. But I feel like the old – like, I think of it like old money versus new money.
For sure.
It's 100%, right? Because the old money – if you go old money, then UCLA's in 100%.
Yeah, but I also think that the Wooden stuff has to taint it a little bit with everyone knowing that it was just different there. I mean, guys are staying –
yeah, but we went over this.
I know.
Who gives a shit?
I don't give a shit. I'm with you on that. But since then, they're such a tricky one. They are literally like the ultimate. I mean, Hallen has 3 straight Final Fours in the 2000s.
I know.
They won a title in 97. Like, it's such a hard thing.
95.
Yeah, 95.
Zona won in 97.
Yeah.
If you step into this podcast, you better come correct.
I was wrong about that. So UCLA, okay.
That makes me feel good to correct
okay,
you.
I'll put Duke and UCLA right there. Like, they have to stay. Duke and UCLA have to be, they're the same thing, just backwards.
Right. And that's fascinating, though.
But they have to be in the first. Those three, the original three we went through, are the ultimate. But Duke and, you can't throw them both out. They have what?
You would never debate that UCLA is basketball royalty.
No.
You can't debate it.
No.
Right? And you never debate that Duke was basketball royalty.
No.
But the question becomes is, who is a college blue blood? And you probably, honestly, if a gun to your head, you're going, you're probably going to say both. But you can honestly make the argument with UCLA that it's lightning in a bottle with Wooden. But what you're saying, and is a great point, is we might be saying the same thing about Duke 30 years from now.
Yeah, I mean, you have a hard time looking at that one. But the thing about UCLA is, even though they haven't won a lot lately, they still get guys going there. And I think part of being a blue blood is there is a little part of that where your players that come there have a ton of success in the NBA too.
Sure.
Kind of like the Jordan Carolina thing. And if you look at UCLA, who they've sent to the league in the last 20 years, it's a bunch of cats too.
Right.
So I think
– okay, bringing this back, because we could do the exact same podcast that we did already all over again and have probably completely different points, which would kind of be funny and fun, and then I could keep having you back, and we do the same shit over and over again.
My
and
wife everybody's is going like, to love this.
And everybody's going to be like, do these guys talk about anything different than that? But to bring it back, that's what stood out to us about the three that we picked last time.
Yeah.
Was the continued success that we picked. Because Kansas is interesting because they don't have as many national titles as some of the teams that we left out.
No.
But they have the conference dominance. They have the win in every decade box checked.
And they have 40 straight years of Roy Williams and Bill Self. Like, it's ultimate consistency.
It's insane.
It's
plus Fog Allen.
Yeah.
Plus pay heat.
The history
sign.
Of all this stuff. Yeah. It's crazy.
It's just, it's all there. It checks all the boxes, right?
Yeah.
So, like, the national championship, because we're going to get into our second tier. I want to start with Michigan State.
Yeah.
It's kind of where I want to start, because I think Michigan State just remains firmly on that bubble of basketball blue blood. And honestly, if I had to say, I would put them in as a blue blood. You know what I mean? Because I think the way we're doing it is weird to me, because I wouldn't tier blue blood programs. I would just say you are a blue blood, you aren't a blue blood. But that's not fun for the podcast. You
No.
know what I mean? But Michigan State, two titles, right? 79-2000, last Big Ten team to win a
Which
national title.
Which is unbelievable for that league to go 20 years without a title.
A joke, right? I mean, that sucks.
It really does.
It sucks. It is. It's unbelievable. Michigan State's been to a ton of Final Fours.
Is it 11 under Izzo?
It's crazy. Crazy amount.
The stat
but
for
he,
him.
But he takes some teams that shouldn't get there.
Always.
There, you know. And so when he gets kind of that rub of like, yeah, Izzo always goes to the Final Four but rarely wins, it's like, well, he's getting there. That's insanely hard.
It is insanely hard, and he's done it a bunch of different ways. Like, he has evolved to a place where he's had some really good one-and-dones, too. Like, Jaren Jackson was a freak. Was Randolph a one-and-done, too?
Yes.
Yeah. So he's had – but he's also been a good developer. So there's a stat out there of him. I think he's had one class ever where they've had – if you stayed there for 4 years, only one class he's ever recruited – didn't play for a Final Four.
Didn't play for
like,
a Final Four.
How do you throw that out? Because
– and Coach K's had that going too, or has had that going to, on a similar thing too, which was like crazy too.
But,
I mean, I don't know where it stands now.
But,
but
Izzo, to his – he wasn't – I mean, he's developed a bunch of guys, a few one-and-dones
here
and there.
He's not stacking the deck with the
yeah,
one
he's
and
not
done.
Pulling like the first, second, fourth overall players.
Kentucky Duke way.
Yeah. But he still went out and got the – the great player, Mike Bridges, was a high-ranked guy. Jaren Jackson was a high-ranked guy. Like, he still got those guys. Gary Harris was a.
I loved Gary Harris in high school.
I thought he was the best
Hamilton
football player
Southeastern.
I've seen. Oh, he was an unbelievable wide receiver, too.
You know, he was super young, too, right?
Really?
Yeah, so he was like, when he – I'll get this wrong, but when he graduated – what are you normally when you graduate high
18,
school?
18, almost.
So, like, 18, I think he was like 16 and a half when he graduated high school, like – or 17. Like, he for
Could've
sure
stayed.
Was like a full year to a year and a half behind, super young.
Was he Mr. Basketball?
Yes.
And then Irvin won the
and
next
then Irvin
year.
Irvin was the next year. Yeah.
Back, I watched Irvin play. I watched those guys play. I think it was Lawrence Central when they had Jeremy Holloway.
Yeah.
And that was, those guys are freaks. That was a different level of high
Your
school basketball.
Like, silky smooth.
Unbelievable. And
it's
Zach
silky,
Harris.
Silky smooth.
Zach Irvin, I'm sorry, was a. I'm a, as a Michigan guy, loved like 18 footer, like coming off the screen, like just unbelievable.
Get out of here.
But unbelievable, those two guys. But Izzo, I mean, like Cassius Winston is going to go down as one of the great Big Ten point guards, and he's been over-recruited almost the early part of his career.
Yeah.
So Izzo's a big develop. He has to be. He's the leader of the second tier to me.
Where's this Michigan State team going this year? You talk about a weird team.
They are.
It's just odd.
And Tillman. Tillman's the way they go, but he's been very, very average lately.
But I can tell you this right now. You and I both won't be shocked if we're doing this podcast and for the Final Four and we're talking about Michigan State being
You don't
want to
see them as like, a four just, or five seed at just, all. Like, no.
You don't bet against Izzo either.
And Cassius Winston, until this past game against Michigan, he's averaged like 28, 8, and 4 against them and just absolutely killed them
right.
when they had good teams.
I always feel like those teams got to get out of the Big Ten. And, like, if you're in the Big Ten, just get out of the Big Ten and make it to the tournament.
Get there.
Forget what happens in the Big Ten. Get in the tournament and just see what happens because most of the time the Big Ten does really well. Now, we just talked about how they've been on this drought, this national championship drought. But if you look at their overall record through – you know, in those 20 years in the tournament, it shines a very favorable light on the conference.
And it's been by multiple different schools, as IU's kind of been in a lull for almost 20 years too. So you think about that's probably arguably one and two the best program in the Big Ten, and they've been not great for 20 years. So you think about like the consistency of the league to have multiple teams go to Final Fours, even without IU.
Is it crazy to you? Like, it's crazy to me to remind myself that IU is three clear of everybody in the Big Ten on national championships.
Knight, when he got there – so it's the exact opposite of Izzo. When Knight got there, he won.
Yeah.
And that's what part of, like, his – like, he got there, unbelievable. Izzo's taken some bad teams – I shouldn't say bad because bad's not fair – and got to a Final Four. And that, for them, was like the ceiling. Like, that was as good as ever. They were going
to
beat
IU hasn't teams. Been to many Final Fours. That's,
no, I think they've been to eight.
Eight.
Yeah, eight.
We just won five of them.
You can't say we.
We.
Yeah, you graduated there. It's okay. You can say, if you graduated there, you can say that.
Don't forget whose podcast this is, dude. You do not make the rules around here, buddy.
89-50, 89-64, 65.
That's all right. That's
all right. So Michigan State has to be in there.
They're
incredible.
And plus they have the icon.
Yeah.
I think that means something. Like UNC with Jordan, you have Michigan State with Magic.
And
it helps to have an icon.
And they beat Indiana State and Larry Bird. So that's like that game is very famous too. So that's it's
you
held.
Ever sit back and think about like how that all shaped up and to carry on into the Celtics, Lakers, and it's just like were we just like blessed by the basketball gods that this shit came together.
So I listened to the Bill Simmons podcast after Kobe died. I was in the YMCA listening to it, and he talks about how those guys saved basketball, which is before my time. I'm born in 85. He's like, those guys coming into the league, and it carries over from a final – from a championship game or Indiana State versus Michigan State. Like, who cares about Indiana State basketball ever?
Yeah.
Until
well,
Larry Bird.
I mean, read those two books. So the two books over there I have is When March Went Mad, which is about that 79 game, and then Bird when the game was ours, Bird and Magic, and it takes you through all of it, and it's incredible. I mean, it's incredible, and then you can even extend it to the Dream Team book that I have over there too, and see the respect that those dudes had.
You're a big reader,
thing. Huh?
You're a big reader.
Yeah, as long as they don't use too many big words, I'm all right. No, man, I can't get enough of that type of stuff, though. You know what I mean? Because because like you said, it's a little bit before our time. So I was young growing up when that stuff was happening. Like, it's always funny to me when people were born after the Dream Team. Like, when somebody tells me that their birthday wasn't till like, 96 or something, I'm like, you realize you missed the Dream Team.
The greatest like team ever assembled.
It's the first thing that I come back with. I'm like, I almost can't even respect you as a person because you missed the Dream Team. How do you miss the Dream Team?
And it's so funny because young guys now will sit there and be like, LeBron better than Jordan, not even close. I'm like, not even close? Like, easy with the like, relax, like, take it back. It's like, the Redeem Team better than the Dream Team? Like, really, really, really good team. And don't get me wrong, comparing eras is difficult.
It is very difficult.
But the Dream Team, like, you cannot – I don't know how you beat them.
Okay, so we're gonna deviate from the pod a little bit here,
yeah,
because it just kind of caught me. But comparing the eras, it's what's going to make Jordan the best ever forever.
Yeah,
because he came on at the perfect time. Because he came on in the age of athleticism when athletes were starting to dominate, and he was the best athlete.
He's a player, right, from today's world, 25 years before his time.
Like, I watched Dr. J highlights. No disrespect to Dr. J, but he's not Michael Jordan. But without Dr. J, you don't get Michael Jordan.
Yes.
Right? So Dr. J came on at the right time. Oscar Robertson came on at the right time. But all of that was the evolution to Jordan. And since then, the evolution hasn't been that great of a leap. I think for the league as a whole, it has been. But for your great, I don't think there's much difference between LeBron and Jordan. Honestly,
no.
From an athleticism
no.
standpoint. A build, yes, but Jordan had that frame, right? He was strong as shit. He was 6'6".
Never missed games.
Didn't miss games.
And I know it's a different time.
Athleticism, but basketball skill, he combined them seamlessly. He just came at the – like, if he comes 15 years before the 84 draft, 85 draft, whatever it was, it's different. We're probably talking about Kobe that way.
Yes.
You know what I mean? It's just a crazy-ass thing to think about. I always find myself wondering there of how these people just kind of came about at the time they came about. It's why, I guess my original point is, it's why I don't see Jordan ever being surpassed. Like,
no,
literally ever.
In the 6 for 6. Like, 6 titles, 6 MVPs. Any.
Okay, but even that, go back and give Bob Cousy 6 MVPs and 6 finals appearances and stuff, and you're still thinking, like, no respect to Bob Cousy, but he's not walking out on this NBA All-Star floor that we're watching tonight and doing anything.
No, not at all. But I also think that's part of, like, the Jordan. It's the whole thing with him, like the fact that he's hit big shots to win titles. He was the dog in the league. He did the dunk contest. He was like the face, like the Jordan brand shoes. Like, he is an entire package that has set the trend for everybody. But he was just 20 years before everyone athletically and skill wise. If you put him in this NBA game today, he's still unbelievable. But he's not a ton different than all those guys.
But these guys aren't who they are without Jordan coming when he came, too. And Jordan's not who he is without Dr. J,
yeah,
and Oscar and those. It's just a phenomenal, like, endless conversation,
yes,
to have, because
it's
fascinating.
The difference between Jordan and number two of his era, which I don't know who you're going to call it, is – the difference between LeBron and Kevin Durant and LeBron and those guys is very minuscule, very, very, very small. The difference between Jordan and two is not even it's not even a discussion from, like, 88
yeah,
to, you know, 90, like, there is no who's number two. Like, that doesn't,
right,
matter. Like, Kevin Durant could be considered, you know, when he was healthy and
for
rolling,
sure,
he's as good as there's ever
he
been.
He was coming for the throne. LeBron's,
yeah,
throne, 100%.
And, like, it's why I think LeBron needs to get his due from older guys, because the dude is in his, what is it, 18th, 17th year in the league?
Yeah.
And he never misses games. He's been the best player in the league or a top three for 15 straight years. So that's part of, like,
my... I have another question for you, but I can't do it because I think we got to save it for another pod.
Oh.
Because we're getting way too
all
far,
right,
off base. I'll bring it up off mic, and we'll see if we want to do one, because I think I could do a whole 30 minutes by myself.
I think
it.
I know what it's going to be, but go back to this. All right, so Michigan State.
Michigan State, we already talked IU. We already talked UCLA. There's two others on our list that we wanted to talk about tonight.
Go for the first one.
Okay, let's go UConn. Cause we did,
Ben Gordon jersey? Can we talk about,
yes,
that?
Yes, he brought me a Ben Gordon jersey. I don't really know if I own it now.
It's not,
or
you
if it's,
do, and it's not even bullshit. Like, it's legit, like, nice, good jersey.
And I am now a proud owner of a double XL Ben Gordon.
Tall. Shout out to Arnie Younger. That's who we got it from.
Man. No, I think it's legit. But UConn, we hit on UConn in the first pod that we did last week. We actually talked a decent amount,
yeah,
about them. What hurts – UConn hurts, in quotation marks, hurts UConn in the blue blood conversation, is they got these shit so fast. Like, you know what,
yeah,
I mean? They just got them so quick. They were stacked right up against each other. One basically seamlessly, like right after another. Every 3-4 years, they were winning another one. But very little before that, which is really super interesting.
And nothing after the Ali. I mean, Ali got fired after winning one.
Sure.
But really nothing after that.
And now struggling a little bit, too. And I love Hurley. I do love Hurley.
And getting back to where they needed to be in the back of the league.
Yeah, we talked a little bit about that because you can recruit the East Coast now.
Yeah.
Being in the Big East and in that stuff, that's going to help. No disrespect to the American, but it's not the Big East.
So it was the number one talked about conversation that people text me about after listening to the pod.
Was.
Because a lot of young people, like younger than me, like my brother-in-law was brought up, and he ended up sending me the clip of when somebody goes, Jim, how does it feel to be the highest paid coach? Yeah. You know, you should shut up.
It's like a minute long, and I start dying laughing.
Love it.
But we start talking about, and we talk about the icons, Ray Allen. Like you talk about guys. Rip. Yeah, like you talk about guys going to the league.
Kimba.
I'll never forget. I was at Ike and Jonesy's. Because I always went to the Big Ten tournament with Kevin Canterbury.
Yeah.
And we go there. KC. And we're at Ike and Jonesy's. And we're sitting there drinking, having a good time. Like, and it's a 6 overtime game.
Yes.
And
Syracuse.
It's like, yes. And I'll never forget that. Like, it was just. And UConn in the Big East tournament. I mean, unbelievable what they would do, too.
So we're going to do. Because we're going out to the Big East this year. Did I tell you that?
You mentioned that last week.
Yeah. So we're going out to the Big East. So I think Meyer and I are going to do a podcast before. We leave on that Georgetown, Iverson, UConn, Ray Allen, where he jumps up. Oh, shit, I have no idea what I'm about to do. Am I going to pass him a shoe, throw it up there, and it rolls in? And I loved Iverson, don't get me wrong. And I love Georgetown, and I love John Thompson and everything he stood for. But if you've listened to our podcast, you know that me and Meyer love Ray Allen. Like, love Ray Allen.
Where does your love come for Ray Allen?
I don't know. He was so awesome at UConn, though. And I think it's because he was a shooter. I bought his shoes that he had at UConn.
Big shoe guy.
Wes used to wear the shorts. He loved those UConn shorts that they wore that we actually recreated. And a lot of people were asking when our shorts are going to be back in stock, March, just for a quick plug there, because I'm getting killed on email and social media. It's coming. There's a reason for the fire sale. There's a reason that we're shutting things down. It'll all make sense in March, and that's all I can say on it. But and we have 2 new UConn pairs coming in March, too. So, anyways, I don't know. I think that's where it comes from. For me, too, though, it was – I went and saw them up in Indy. So when UConn was the number one seed in the NCAA tournament, they got sent to the Midwest. And so my mom took me and LC out of Brian Claiborne, out of school. We got to drive up there, and we had really good seats for whatever reason. I don't know how we got them, but we had, like, seats behind the basket a few rows up. But when they were warming up, they would let all the kids go down to, like, on the floor, like, right, you know, still in the stands, but, like, right next to this dude, Ray Allen. Let me just tell you. You're laughing. Because I'm getting animated over here.
You're getting excited.
And I got my hands moving. Glided. He didn't run. He didn't move side to side. He glided. He moved differently than every other person on every other team in every other game that we watched. And then that's when I was kind of like, you know, that dude right there, number 34, Ray Allen, like, I'm pretty sure he's going to be a Hall of Famer.
Jesus Shuttlesworth?
I mean, it was incredible. And obviously, silky smooth in his release in a jump shooter. You know, Iverson, like our namesake, high-volume shooter. Iverson was a high-volume shooter, right? But he was a dog. He would just go get it. Just go get it. And I loved him for that. And I loved him for being a high-volume shooter and stuff. Ray Allen was just one of those, like, he was just beautiful to watch.
He's a complete package. People think of him as a shooter late in his career, but he's actually like a great athlete.
Incredible. He's in dunk contests and everything. He was
incredible. People forget that, especially younger people, like, oh, Ray Allen's just one of the greatest shooters of all time.
No.
Ray Allen's like one of the great guards who
great
could do it all,
players
too.
Players of the generation.
Yes.
And so was Iverson. They were just 2 completely different players, and I kind of gravitated more towards Ray Allen. And honestly, just for an Indiana kid, it was just because he was silky smooth with his jump
Iverson
shot.
Stepping over Tyronn Lue is one of my favorite things of all
but
time.
But see, I love Georgetown Iverson. So
no
much
tatted
more.
Up Iverson.
I love Concord Jordan 11
Ooh,
wearing
you're right.
Iverson. I love Tip Dunk Iverson.
When
I
did
love,
you first?
I love 2-time Big East Defensive Player of the Year Allen Iverson.
We're talking about practice, not a game we love.
I loved him in Philly too. Yeah. Although I had a hard time getting past those terrible ass jerseys they wore that had the shoulder pad, shoulder width.
Eric Snow.
Good God. If Eric Snow walked in here right now, you would shoot him for dollars and have no fear that you were going to lose.
So, Allen Iverson.
Oh.
When was the first time you got a Concord? First time you got Concords.
First time I got the Concords was the story I told on this podcast. It was whenever it was, 2012, probably,
yeah.
2011. I didn't have them originally. There's
me
a whole
neither.
Backstory before it. I don't
right,
want to get
fair.
Into it. But and there's a whole story of me getting them, too. And then I just got the recent ones that came out last year or whatever it was, 2 years ago. They're still on ice. I usually wear all my stuff. I haven't worn those yet.
I still have a pair sitting in the – I just got the white and military blue.
I'm
going to
wear them. Our next podcast, I'll wear them.
I'll bring my turtle doves.
Yeah.
I haven't worn those.
All right. We need to do a shoe pod.
That would be my favorite because I'm actually in shoes.
See, this is the problem with
you.
Our asses, though. We come down here, we just start talking.
All right. So UConn to finish up. That 20-year run, which the tier, you have four titles.
It's insane. It's incredible. It's incredible. But where do they go from here, and what did they have before? I know there was a little history there before, but there were no national championships and stuff, and that's why you have to knock them to that second tier. That's why we're talking about more now. But
sending guys too. They kept sending guys and guys. I mean, Charlie Villanueva, who's a really good college player, 6'11". I mean, they had Boone on one of those teams too. Like, Okafor is a big.
Yeah.
So he had a bunch of bigs, really good guards too.
And but is it the Knight effect?
Yeah, it has to be.
Maybe. You don't know yet because time hasn't like borne that out.
I think Hurley getting them back in the Big East will be a big tell for them where they go from here.
Yes.
Because if they struggle,
I think he's a good coach.
Yeah.
I really do.
If they struggle for the next 10 years and they go to third, even with four titles.
I think you can call it on IU with Knight. I think we've had enough.
Yeah.
Time after.
Took a bath.
No, I do think IU will eventually get back, and
for
IU
sure.
will eventually have some runs.
Took
and
a took a Danny
fours
Fulton
and,
called me the other day. Goes, how do you guys think IU's up there? I'm like, come on.
Fulton always argues to me about that.
He said Raleigh is a way better. Like, Bloomington's a terrible town. I'm like, you can say a lot of
things.
That's
where your argument ends.
That's crazy. Like, Bloomington is one of the – I hate IU, like, athletics and Michigan. Bloomington's as cool as you can get.
Great college town.
We won't go there. All right, IU is on the list. We've already beat that one to death.
We talked
about last one.
Yeah, we talked about this team, though. We did talk about them on the –
Not
the
a ton.
One too. Yeah, so it's Nova. And Nova is, like, very parallel to Michigan State, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, I really do, because they have that one title in 85 that was like
out of nowhere.
Legendary.
Yeah.
But it's really not maybe out of nowhere as you think if you kind of trace that team or follow that team or are watching any of the documentaries and stuff.
It's 85, right?
Yeah, 85.
Yeah.
But still nobody expected them to beat Georgetown, Hoya paranoia and all that good stuff, which is awesome. We'll talk about Georgetown more.
They got to go somewhere.
Next pod?
They got to be around there, right? They got to be.
but then the recent success. And then Jay Wright, right? Because Jay Wright's going to be your Knight, your Izzo, your Calhoun, perhaps.
Jay
Wright. I mean, he's already got two.
He's a dog.
He's already got two. So how much longer? I don't even know how old he is.
Mid-40s? Probably late 40s.
Got to be later 40s.
He dresses well, too.
Yeah, he does a nice job over there on the sidelines, looking dapper.
But, man, he doesn't.
But so, I mean, but then again, you don't know, like, Knight and Calhoun are, like, basketball dudes. Like, that was their life. You never know, if he wants to say, like, hey, I've had my run, I'm done. You just don't know in the future. If there's so many more opportunities out there for coaches. Like, I can totally, and I don't know him at all. Don't know the situation, don't follow it at all. But I can see him going the Al McGuire route and retiring a little bit younger to be able to do other stuff and things like that.
It's kind of funny about we talk about some of these blue blood jobs where they just have so much, like, the history's forever there. The expectations are through the roof. Like, I don't think that's the same with J-Rod at Villanova. I think he's created a lot of the expectations, sure. Kind of like where Bennett has it at Virginia. Like, this is what we do. Like, this is how we are. And Wright's kind of done that there, too, where he's not at a place like Kansas or a place where these expectations are through the roof. Like, you have to recruit really well. You have to do this.
And I don't think he's ever leaving either. I think that's really important, too. It's not any kind of stepping stone. I mean, he's got shit rolling.
Yeah, what job does he even think about? I mean, if Duke ever goes outside the family, maybe. But
why?
I don't think he wants that. No, he doesn't.
I just can't see it.
And he's a big –
Now, if he didn't have any national championships at Villanova – Maybe you take that to say, like, hey, I can compete for national championship. He's doing that.
He recruits at a high level, too, like a really, really high level.
It's interesting. It's interesting how much emphasis is put on Villanova, with the Big East and stuff, too. So all those teams and all those coaches and all those players respect the shit out of what they're doing at Villanova because it's helping that conference a ton, too, because there's no football.
No, it's basketball only. Basketball is the only thing they have.
Right, which is awesome.
And Jay Wright is a perfect fit for the East Coast. Like, that, he always talks about, like, the Northeastern guards. So, right. That's kind of where he is. Like, what else is he going to go take that's going to
– So they have three natties, right?
Yep.
I'm not sure how many Final Fours that they have, but they have three national championships. It's not crazy to think that Jay Wright can get one to two more at all.
No, because his teams get better too. Like, and I don't think he's never been a big one and done guy too. So I think part of the run that he has is that he gets guys that stay, and he's a great developer, and he's a great, and they do all that. I don't think it's impossible for him to think that he could snag up. I mean, if he gets one or two more, you're talking about putting him in the level of guys that are up way up there.
I mean, he's already a Hall of Famer. He's already a legend, but you're getting in rarefied air.
Yeah, you get two. Like that. I mean, Patino's got two.
Two's insane, but three is that there's a tier there from two to three, for sure.
Like, one's hard. Two is incredible. You get above two, like, you're a different guy.
Well, Kay has five, and I would argue he's the greatest to ever do it.
Yeah, he is.
At five.
Has to be, because Roy's in his heyday too at the same time,
right?
I mean, there's been three titles.
That's going to be really interesting, because that's where I was going to take it from there. Is who are the coaches that we're going to see in programs we're going to see over the next 20 years? And I know that's almost impossible to say, but if you're looking at it at 2020 right now, who are those programs that are going to continue to be
where Chris Beard ends up?
You're bullish on that.
My 100, that's my stock. If I could buy stock in any young guy, Tim.
Okay, but
he'll take a big job.
But we don't even know where he's going.
He's taking Texas. Shaka's going to be in DePaul next year.
Yeah, but is Texas a great job?
It's where he's from. Is Texas Tech a great job? And he's got that place rolling.
Well, yeah. I mean, they have success.
But the ability's there for him to do what he wants there. Like, the money's there. The state's there. Like, the school is there.
Yeah, so Texas is really interesting.
It really is.
Because they have all the money in the world.
Yeah.
Right?
And it's a good basketball state.
Their athletics is struggling and has been struggling for a while.
So
both sides.
Did you see Fran Fraschilla's talk about that the other day?
No.
It's one of the worst stretches of Texas athletics of all time.
Right, because you can throw money at any of that problem.
They've got more money than they know what to do with, and they can't. And they throw the money at every issue, and it's just. I thought Shaka would actually be a great fit.
I did too.
Texas. I thought he'd be unbelievable.
He doesn't go to Texas just all of a sudden not become a good coach. It's just not the way it works.
And his VCU team's played really, really hard too.
Right.
It's kind of like the Archie to IU thing. Like, Dayton was
really
good.
But you see it all the time.
Yeah.
You just see it all the time. But I always am – like, these guys don't forget how to coach basketball. They're still really good basketball minds.
Yeah.
There's just so many little variables that have to line up for everything to work out. That's what makes the greats insanely great.
I think the hard part about some of those guys taking jobs that you think are perfect places to set up for is that they recruit a level of guy. like Mo Bamba goes in there as a one and done, where maybe it's you get a lower level guy at VCU that you know you're going to have for 5 years.
Well, I think that,
and I think that you get caught up in that, like how K and
because
Cal
you
do
you
that.
Know that you have a shot at those guys now, so you start recruiting them, but yet,
for sure.
But yet your strength is maybe in the development of those lower three-star guys that are going to stay. It's an interesting
and the
concept.
VCU teams would dog walk these Texas teams.
Oh, for sure.
I mean, they would get in the
– But those teams were a lot of fun to watch. Those VCU teams would get
full
in
court,
your ass,
go.
That was they were like Arkansas 40 minutes of hell, an upgraded version. You know?
And they were good year after year. Like, they would reload still. It was crazy.
Yeah, it was. And had good players, too. I mean, good college players. Really good college players. Yeah, I don't know. To me, the two guys that stand out are Wright and Bennett.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like those two guys, and it would be fun to see them battle for a few natties down the line, too.
I think because they recruit to what they want.
Exactly.
They're not going like – the great part about Coach K is like, if Zion says I'm coming to Duke, like, okay, I'm going to say no to you.
Well, here's the thing. There's going to be a changing of the guard.
Yeah, those guys are all up there.
Old. Boeheim's old. Roy's old. Coach K is old. You know, you're talking about three institutes that are institutions that are just going
And you're
to,
talking about some of these guys that have been out
Izzo,
lately, too.
Izzo's old, too. I mean
Pitino, when he left, too, was a big deal, too.
Fucking legit jobs opening up.
Yeah.
So who fills those? How does that play into?
So because
you think that Bennett and Wright are staying where they're at. So those guys aren't going anywhere.
I think
they're
one of the most intriguing places is Chris Mack at Louisville. And they're not on this because Louisville
will be in the next pod.
Has to
I'll be fighting for him to be
so
on
the
there
crazy thing
agree.
Is their AD is probably one of the greatest ADs of all time, transitioning them from the Big Conference USA to the ACC.
You're talking about the dude that got fired.
Yes.
Yeah.
But, dude, put their athletics on the map.
Also got that beer deal done, too, before it was, like, popular to do it.
And if you've ever been to a game at the Yum Center, which we talk about going to Fog, and we are going to Fog next year.
Yes.
Approved it.
Yes.
Then deal. Going to Louisville, which I just went for a Louisville-Michigan game, but I went to Louisville, Carolina a couple years ago. That place is
– You were telling me it was legit.
It's unbelievable. And it is the most Western school in the ACC, so they can pull those Midwestern kids – that are still close to home and still playing the best league in the country.
Yeah, Louisville geographically is situated pretty nice because they can come into Indiana and pull some kids too.
And it's an awesome place to be.
Right. Interesting.
That's the next one. The third tier to me is the most interesting because there's not a ton of arguments in the first two. The third tier is where you get to a
For
point
sure.
where you're just like,
And I think it's also important, too, to say that there's not much drop-off from the teams that we're talking about or the programs we're talking about from one to two to even three. You know,
they all go up and
all
down.
Amazing programs. Amazing. With crazy good tradition, you know.
Like, we haven't talked – we talked about Bennett, but we haven't put them in one, two.
No.
He's won the ACC three straight times or three times in 5 years and has a national title, too.
Right, but Virginia as a whole, you know, you're thinking in Ralph
Sampson
era,
there's a big gap between that, too.
We're going to have to do our homework. Like, that's the thing. The first couple are pretty
easy. You show up and drink a beer and let's go.
Jesus Christ. Now I'm going to have to actually go and look shit up. I need a stat guy, man.
anybody got an intern for us?
Can anybody look up some shit?
We got good gear.
exactly. All right, Dan, I appreciate you coming down here, man. We're going to wrap this up, and then we'll come back. We'll try to come back maybe next week and hit that third tier and beyond. We don't have to do this every time either. We can talk about other stuff.
We got plenty of things.
Yeah, exactly, like your vacation photos and that Paul Pierce halter top. So, all right, brother, I appreciate you. Well, let's go watch the rest of the NBA All-Star.
All right.
Thank you for listening to the 19.9 podcast with HVS, the High Volume Shooters. For more information, check out the blog at 19.9.com under HVS. And while you're there, do yourself a favor and pick up some retro college shorts. Till next time.